The clustering of SAS metadata servers is a feature which was introduced with the release of SAS 9.4. This video explains how the concept of Quorum works with the metadata cluster to ensure consistent and robust performance. I'm Rob Collin with SAS, and this is the Technical Insights and Expertise series. So what is a cluster? In this discussion, a cluster is a coordinated set of identical software servers which act together to provide a single, highly available, high-performance service. With that in mind, what is a quorum? The quorum we need is the minimum number of members necessary to perform work. Taking those concepts together to build a metadata cluster allows us to start with a single metadata server, one you might already have in your current environment. To make a metadata cluster, you just need to deploy additional nodes. We require a minimum of 3 nodes for a metadata server cluster, and we strongly recommend that each of those nodes is hosted on its own physical machine. That way, a single hardware failure can't take out more than one metadata server. Now, the deployment order of those metadata servers is important to our discussion today. If you have just one metadata server in your environment, then by definition, it's the first metadata server, and it's fully capable of acting alone to deliver metadata services. To make a cluster, you're going to deploy additional nodes, but we're going to keep track of which one is the first node that we installed. A cluster can have more than 3 nodes. You can install as many as you want. There's no upper limit. However, we find that 3 is usually more than sufficient for almost every scenario. Configuration of the metadata cluster, therefore, includes that first configured node, which is the first instance of a SAS metadata server as set up by the SAS deployment wizard. The first configured node will act as tiebreaker in certain situations when deciding quorum, as we'll see later in this discussion. The additional nodes, the second one, the third one, the fourth one, are all added alongside that first metadata server and are used to create the cluster. We can add or remove nodes from our cluster as needed. There's no maximum limit to the number of additional nodes that we have defined and installed. A metadata cluster has one control node and multiple workers. Now, for a single metadata server that's acting standalone, it doesn't have any such role because it's all by itself. In a cluster, though, one of those nodes will take on the control role. The other nodes will all act as workers. What we show here on this third example is that the control node can really be any of the machines in your environment. It doesn't always have to be the first machine. The point being is that a metadata node may take on either of the following roles. It can be a control node. Control nodes are elected when the cluster starts up. The rule is that it's usually going to be the earliest deployed node of the first 2 metadata servers that get launched and come online. That can change over time due to synchronization and failure recovery rules. The control node is responsible for coordinating metadata updates across the entire cluster. So if a new object gets created, permissions change, reports are added, then the metadata server acting as a control node ensures that those updates get written across all the nodes of the cluster. Tracking the addition or removal of any node of the cluster is another responsibility of the control node. So he keeps track of however many nodes are defined and which ones are currently up and running and active. New incoming client connections for metadata service get assigned by the control node to individual workers on a round-robin basis. Worker nodes are any of the other nodes that aren't acting as a control node. They will talk directly to the control node and pretty much ignore all the other workers, except at startup time when a control node is being elected. Worker nodes handle read requests from metadata directly. They don't need coordination from the control node to do that. Each worker has its own copy of metadata on disk and in memory. They don't share a common location for that, and so that's how they're able to handle those read requests directly. The worker nodes will forward metadata updates to the control node so that it can ensure those changes to metadata are committed successfully across all nodes of the environment. An individual worker node isn't required to be up and running as long as we have a minimum necessary to maintain quorum. For a metadata cluster, a quorum of nodes is needed so that the entire cluster will appear to be online and responsive to incoming requests for metadata. A quorum will exist for us when more than half of our metadata nodes are online and communicating with each other. Or if we have exactly half of the nodes, and that exact half includes the first node which was ever deployed. They all need to be online and communicating with each other. Either of those situations will give us quorum. We can check on the status of quorum and our metadata cluster in the management console. So when visiting the management console, we can see that our cluster is currently in a state of quorum and that the master role or the control role is taken on by the machine known as SAS Server 01. In this case, it also happens to be the first deployed node, and we can see that denoted here. The worker nodes, in this case, SAS Server 3 and SAS Server 2, are both up and running, and so all three nodes that we have defined in our environment are up and running, and we do have quorum. Now, let's talk about situations where quorum might come into question. What happens if some of our nodes go offline for some reason and we run the risk of losing quorum? In this example, we have a cluster that contains three metadata server nodes. The control node is running on one of the additional servers, and the first deployed server is in a worker node role at this moment. Now, we're going to take that last worker node offline for whatever reason. Do we have quorum? Yes, we certainly do. The rule is that we need to have more than half of our nodes online and communicating with each other to have quorum. Two is more than half of three. Doesn't matter that the first node got lost. So we're okay. We do have quorum. Metadata service is still available to all of our users, and they can continue operations. In this next environment, we have a six-node cluster of metadata servers, and we're going to take three of them offline. Looking at this particular example, do we have quorum? Yes, we do indeed. When three of our nodes went down, we lost exactly half of our cluster, but the other half stayed online, and that half continues to operate with the first deployed node. Remember, the first deployed node acts as a tiebreaker in this situation in determining quorum for the nodes that have exactly half the machines. So yes, we do have quorum. Now, the remaining worker nodes will briefly go offline so that they can elect a new control node. And with that done, we now have an operational metadata cluster with a subset of nodes that can continue conducting business for our users. Let's look at this next example. We have that same six-node cluster of metadata servers, but this time we're going to take the other three offline. And so we're left with exactly half the nodes up and running, including the original control node. Do we have quorum? No, we do not. Even though we have exactly half, and that exact half still has the original control node, we no longer have the first deployed node in that exact half. So therefore, the remaining nodes of the metadata server will go offline, and any new requests that come in for metadata from clients will get a server paused message. The three nodes that are offline will wait until quorum can be reestablished. Now, let's look at another kind of example to make clear why quorum is so important to us, because there are situations where service is not about an individual node going offline or a machine going offline, but maybe due to some sort of network issue. So here we have a 6-node cluster of metadata servers, and they are on different subnets, that is, different isolated networks, and they had a connection between those isolated networks that kept them in contact. Well, we lost that connection. And so now we have 3 nodes up and running on subnet A, and we also have 3 nodes up and running on subnet B. The host machines and the SaaS software are running no problem, but all 6 machines can't see each other. 3 can see each other on A, and 3 can see each other on B. We have to ask ourselves, in both of those areas, do we have quorum? Looking at subnet A, no, we don't. We have exactly half the nodes of our cluster up and running, but we don't have the first node. And so therefore, subnet A's cluster of metadata servers will enter an offline state and wait for quorum to be reestablished. Moving over and looking at subnet B, we do indeed have quorum. We still have our original, our first deployed machine, and the workers will then elect a new control node, and metadata service will resume in short order on subnet B with very little interruption to service. The reason why we take this approach is to avoid a problem known as split brain. So let's look at that briefly. In this scenario, we cannot perform updates to metadata across all 6 nodes of our environment. We can only update 3 machines at a given time due to the loss of that network bridge between those 2 subnets. If we allowed our metadata subcluster on the A subnetwork to continue functioning, even if we put it only in read-only mode, the metadata that's stored there would probably diverge over time from what's happening in the active subcluster B. Subcluster B is a fully operational metadata service at this point, and so not only is it satisfying read requests, but it could be handling write requests to metadata as well. New report objects created, new permissions defined, new users added or removed from the environment, and so none of those updates are making their way across that network bridge over to subnet A, and that could be a problem. This approach, where we take that isolated cluster offline to deal with split brain, sacrifices the highest possible availability that we could offer with the cluster. We do that, however, to ensure metadata correctness for all of our users. We never want to be in a situation where we're providing the wrong metadata. Wrapping up in summary, with SAS 9.4, you have the option of clustering your SAS metadata server. Determining the availability of that cluster of metadata servers is based on the rules of quorum. For a SAS metadata server cluster, quorum is achieved when we have more than half of our cluster nodes online and communicating with each other, or if we have exactly half the cluster nodes, which include the first deployed node acting as a tiebreaker, and they're all online and communicating with each other. Without quorum, any remaining nodes of the cluster that are still running will enter an offline state. These quorum rules help ensure that metadata is consistent and current for all of our users. Thank you for viewing this video. Be sure to check back here with the Technical Insights and Expertise series for more information, demonstrations, and examples across a wide range of topics with SaaS software.